Heavenly Father, in Jesus' mighty name, let your name be glorified today, even as we share your word. Let your name be honored wherever this voice is heard today. In the name of Jesus, we pray and give thanks. Hallelujah. It's an honor and a privilege to meet you again on this platform and to walk with you and to see the things God is doing and to have fellowship with one another, although on a different platform. And it's been my prayer, and it's the prayer of all of us in the nation, that the Lord of all grace will vindicate our nation and cause the daughters of Zion to be gathered again in his house. But before then, we have a business to do, as we said the last time, that even in the days of prison, Paul continued ministering to the church through his works that are such a blessing to us today. For those of us joining us for the very first time, I'm Pastor Samuel, ministering with Kagumo People's Church, better led at SKPC, and it's been a joy, and we've really enjoyed ourselves as we interact with each other on this platform and share the words of grace, building the body of Christ as the Lord has put his mandate upon our lives. Today we begin on a different platform and on a pretty different journey from what we've been taking, and we'll be taking on a discussion on a topic I'm calling Issues of Heart. Issues of the Heart. I'm reading from the book of Luke, chapter 6. I'll read from verses 31 to that 5, taking from NLT version. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. If you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward from heaven will be very great, and you will truly be acting as children of the Most High. For he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. Today we begin to share with us on levers that are supposed to flow from the heart. Bible says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows issues of life. And we begin to share with us, brothers and sisters, on some of the ailments, I'll call them, that aileth the heart of man. Things that hold back the children of the Most High from becoming what they ought to be. And number one, and the mother of all, is called bitterness. What is bitterness? Bitterness is an accumulation of upsets of life. Bitterness is a response to issues that have happened to you over a time. It's a dispensation of the heart towards circumstances or issues or people that in your own view have caused you to go through certain pain or another. When you are upset, many things begin to happen. You become frustrated, and frustrations manifest in many ways. Frustrated people, my brother and sister, are dangerous people, because frustrations is a time bomb. Frustrated people can cause a lot of damage because they become easily agitated. They are easily angry. The problem with bitterness is that it affects your spiritual maneuverability, because bitterness is heavy. It's heavy. It's such a burden to the soul. Such a burden to the soul. Bible says in the book of Proverbs, chapter 18, verse 14, the human spirit can endure a sick body, but who can bear a crushed spirit? Bitterness crushes the spirit of a man. You realize slowly but surely a new character begins to be introduced into your life.
Your temperament begin to shift. You are no longer the kind of well-mannered person you used to be. It's affecting how you relate with the people now. You realize soon people begin to keep away from you. There is like a scratching all over your skin, and you become itchy, and people begin to withdraw from you because they need to protect their spirits from your itchy you. It begins to affect your dreams. It begins to affect your future. Soon you become a candidate of ministrations. Someone now must counsel you. Someone now must begin to comfort you and to console you. You are once this beaming lady, this beaming man, but all of a sudden you have become sulky, and most of the times you are withdrawn to yourself because bitterness is a graveyard. It's a graveyard. Where bitterness resides, there is no pumping of joy. Question would be, as we begin to move on, how then, having narrated to us what bitterness is, how do you deal with bitterness? Bible says the book of Ephesians, Paul writing the church, the book of Ephesus, chapter 4, verse 31 to verse 32. I'm reading again from the NLT version. It says, get rid of all bitterness. Get rid of all bitterness. Telling you that you can get rid of some bitterness. But the Bible advises, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander. You see, when you are bitter, bitterness births rage. Bitterness births anger. People who have bitterness have harsh words. And over time, they begin to slander. You soon realize someone who couldn't be associated with other people's issues, all of a sudden is now being sought to be questioned on things he said about people. You ask yourself, why a change, why a drift effect of bitterness on the soul of that man? He says, as well as all types of evil behavior, he says, instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. Number one, to deal with bitterness, refuse to keep grudges. What are grudges? Grudges are unsettled scores that leave open wounds in the spirit of a man. They are like acid. They keep on opening wounds that were afflicted to you wrongly or rightfully, and hinder them from healing. As healing stays away from your spirit, memories pile up. So you realize that years are going, but this thing doesn't leave your mind. The problem with grudge is that it eats the good out of the best and results to creation of ministers from masters of excellence. When you read from the book of 2 Samuel chapter 2, verses 12 to 14, we have a display, a good learning place where we can clearly see from the scriptures what grudges do. Bible says, I'm reading from the book of 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 12 to 14, NLT version again. Says, one day Abner led Ishbosheth troops from Mahanaim to Gibeon. About the same time, Joab, son of Zeruiah, led David's troop out and met them at the pool of Gibeon. The two groups are down there, facing each other from opposite sides of the pool. Then Abner suggested to Joab, let's have a few of our warriors fight hand to hand here in front of us. All right, Joab agreed. See, we have a scenario, brothers and sisters, of two camps in the days of David when Saul was still the king. And the leaders of the troop met at a certain pool, and after discussions, it was agreed that they should engage in war, like what we have today in Lesotho. And the Bible says the battle became worse. If you read from verse 20 to 22, it says, when Abner looked back and saw him coming, he called out, "Is that you, Asahel?" "Yes, it is," he replied. He said, "Go find someone else Abner wants. Take one of the young men and strip him of his weapon." But as Asahel kept right on chasing Abner, again Abner shouted to him, "Get from here. I don't want to kill you. How could I ever face your brother Joab again?" Now you see, in the midst of the pain and the battle, Joab had a brother. Joab had a brother. The Bible calls his brother Asbel. And Abner is a seasoned man of war. He's an elder in war. And he realizes that his team is losing, so he begins to flee. But this young man, because he's full of energy, the Bible says that when he was faster than a gazelle, and he pursued this old man said to this young guy, "Is that you?" And he said, "His eyes said, pursue another one. I'm warning you. I don't want to take you out because I have respect for your brother. When I kill you, what would happen? Will I tell your brother?" The Bible says, if you continue leading, that the guy wouldn't budge. He wouldn't listen. And the Bible says, Abner took him out. He killed him. And Abner tried to settle scores. He tried to talk to Israel. Verse 26 of the same chapter says, Abner called to Joab and said, "Shall the sword depart forever? Knowest thou not that it will be bitterness in the latter end? How long shall it be then, ere that bind the people return from following their brethren?" You see, Abner tries to convince Joab that this is not good. And the Bible says on that day, Joab behaved like he has had the counsel of Abner after many years. 2 Samuel chapter 3, verses 20. Bible says, Abner and 20 of his men came to Hebron to David, and Bible says David entertained them with a great feast. You see now, in the course of time, Saul's son claimed that Abner is having a relationship with Rizpah, one of king's concubines, and it grieved Abner so much, and Abner thought of coming from the camp of Saul into the camp of David. And the Bible says when he visited Hebron to David with 20 men, David received him gladly. Many, many years, Abner has no correction that these guys, some of them, did not move on in life. They have grudges, they have issues of heart, that they have scores they have not settled. And on this day, Bible says that Job was not present. When Job returned, Bible says he was mad. He was so angry. But look at his response before the king. Verse 24, 25, he says, "So Job went to the king and said, 'What have you done? Look, Abner came to you. Why did you let him go? Now he is gone. You know Abner, son of Nah, very well. He came to deceive you and observe your movement and found out everything you are doing.'" See, Job tells the king why he is angry with Abner. It's because Abner is spying on the truth of Israel. But is that true? Was that the reason? When you continue reading, you realize Bible says they pursued Abner secretly and told Abner, write to him, that the king has another word. And Abner came back. Abner is trying to strike peace. Abner is trying to make peace. Abner is trying to move on. He is tired of this life. So he comes. And guess what? Bible says, Job speared this man in cold blood and killed him. Why did he kill him? Verse 20, chapter 3 says, Job and his brother Abishai murdered Abner because he had killed their brother Asahel. But what did he tell the king? This man is a spy. But the scripture shows that he didn't kill him because he was a spy. He killed him because he had scores to settle. There are issues of heart that they are not letting go. Learn to let go. Know when it is no longer working. Don't be left behind when others are moved on. Because there are consequences to that. Bible says, chapter 3, verse 29, when David, the anointed king of Israel, heard what they had done with his anointing and priestly effort, rose up in the prophetic song, and he said, let it fall on the head of Job and all his father's house, and let the house of Job never be without one who has a discharge, who is a leper, or who walks on a crutch, or who is a distaff holder, unfit for war, or who falls by the sword, or who languishes in poverty. The king was so wounded. He said, how could you murder one anointed of the Lord in cold blood? What were these issues that you are not able to overcome? And as a result, he spoke a curse over one of his best friends. Grudges separate the best of friends. Grudges are acidic. They kill relationships. Marriages have been broken. Sons have left home, never to return, because of issues of the heart. Understand this, my brother. There are those who don't like you, who never like you, have never liked you. The best cure in life for those who don't like you is let your father deal with them, and don't tell your father about them in prayer. And I'll repeat that one again. There are those who don't like you. Let them deal with your father. And don't even tell your father about them. They are necessary baggage in your spirit. Stop painting for the bright. Stop singing for the deaf. Look at the prodigal son. Bible says in the book of Luke, chapter 15, verse 25-28, this time I'll read from Messenger version. All this time, his old son was out in the field. When the day's work was done, he came in. As he approached the house, he heard music and carousing. Calling over one of the house boys, he asked what was going on. He told him, your brother has come home. Your father has ordered a feast, barbecued beef, because he has him home safe and sound. The older brother stalked off in angry sulk and refused to join in. When you read that story, I know many of us are familiar with the story. We have this vagabond who has come back home with gaps in character. And the Bible, when you read the context, you're able to see that the elder brother had issues with this young person all his life. Because number one, when he asked to be given his inheritance, he never assisted him in counsel. Number two, when he left, he never went to pursue him, but the Bible says he knew where he was, because he lectured his father that he spent his money with prostitutes, telling you then that he also joined in that kind of prostitution, only that he was a wiser person. Otherwise, how did he know that his son, his younger brother, was a prostitute? Issue came out when this young man came back home. But I'm trying to show you, when the younger brother came in and the father received him, he never tried to explain to himself before the older brother. He did let the older brother deal with the father about his issues. That's what I'm telling you. There are people who never approve of you. Let them settle their issues with your father. There are people who never see that you have changed. There are people, no matter how much you try to wash you, who always see specs on you. Stop wasting your life on them. Move on. It's a fact of life. You will not please everyone. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Don't give them one of your valued things in life. Time. Stop wasting so much energy trying to prove yourself before them. Learn to enjoy yourself. People who are not happy, understand this, who always try to stop others from being happy. Blessed be the name of Jesus. The last one. For today, sellers who continue learning these things, we might not be able to finish this on a single day. Stop loving your trouble. Let's say that one again. Stop loving your trouble. There are people who love what they are going through. How do you know they love it? They never stop talking about it. Every time you see them down, same story. Every time in prayer meeting, same request. Every time when you're having some jokes around, same thing. When you don't seem like you're noticing, they withdraw. They're always pretending to be victims of circumstances. Don't walk that road. Don't walk that road. God made us for His own pleasure. And for Him to be happy, you got to be happy. Give you the best. Stop putting your spirit so much around what happened around you. And seek to discover what is ahead of you. What is ahead of you? Give this life the best of you. And I will say something. Don't give your trouble you. The greatest gift you can give in this world is you. There is no greater gift in this world that is greater than you in your life. Don't trade you for anything else. Don't trade you for anything else. Including your pain you're going through. Times healing begins when your spirit is separated from the pain you're going through. That's when healing begins. Because you see, bitterness and issues of life are infectious. They are septic. When you detach, you keep your spirit clean. And the Bible says, a joyful spirit is able to bring healing to entire body. But a broken spirit is hard to contend with. Hard to keep. It means it's hard to sustain. When your spirit is broken, you are like a city without a wall. Your spirit, anything and anyone can pass through you. Refuse to walk in life naked. Learn to guard your heart. Learn to keep yourself together. Bible says in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 3, verse 17, 19. I'm reading from Messenger version. Though the cherry trees doesn't blossom, and the strawberries don't ripen, though the apples are worm eaten, and the wheat fields stunted, though the sheep pens are sheepless, and the cattle barns are empty, I am singing joyful praise to God. I am turning cartwheels of joy to my Savior God, counting on God's rule to prevail. See, it says, my joy is independent of circumstances of life. Whether faith is working or not working, whether life seems to be moving on or I'm the one moving on, I've made up my mind that I will be made to be joyful and stop loving me when I'm in trouble. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord sustain you. You are responsible for your joy. You're responsible for your joy. Guarding your heart is your responsibility, not God's responsibility. And He has given us tools to make that happen. Until we meet again, my brothers and sisters, Shalom. God bless you.